Hello, I'm Gavin Hoey, and I'm just about to do a live streaming session all about the art of the heart, where I'm going to show you how to photograph hearts in various different ways. But don't worry if you didn't catch it live, because this is the edited highlights. The only reason I'm going to use flash for this particular setup is it has this on the top. Let me bring that in. That is a conical snoot. And the only light that I have that has a conical snoot is a fitment for this particular flash. This snoot should fire a fairly neat circle of light. It's not an optical snoot. It's not going to be a perfect circle of light, but it should be a reasonably neat circle of light. And if I just sort of come from above this one and just put my camera into manual mode, because that would definitely make a difference. So I've now worked with flash, and you can see, hey, that worked okay. So my circle of light stretches out, curves around the folds of the book, and becomes a heart shape. And if I just come down a little bit lower, something like that, we should really be able to extend that just by changing the angle that I'm shooting at. So I'm actually going to use the marble on the book in that heart shape of light. The marble is round, if you think of it as a two-dimensional shape, it's round. So in theory, this should cast a heart shape as well. That's the theory. Let's just pop it somewhere down there. Lovely. Let's grab a camera and see how this works. So I'll shoot from above. Okay, let's see. Ooh. Okay, yeah, that kind of works. It helps if I put my glasses on, that's better, I can see now. You can see that we have the marble, which is casting a shadow, which has fairly crisp edges, wraps around the folds of the book, but even the little hot spot from the centre of the marble has that sort of heartish feel, but it doesn't have the point at the top of the heart. It doesn't have this bit up here. So in order to get that, all I'm going to have to do is one of the hardest things in photography. I'm going to have to move. Because as photographers, we get stuck. We always end up doing the same thing, and you think, oh, this is great, and you don't move your feet, or you don't change the height. In fact, moving your feet is actually easier than changing the height, the angle at which you shoot. And the angle at which you shoot can radically change what you're photographing. In this case, yes, it will. Because as I drop myself a little lower down, there it is. So I'm going to do, well, I'm not going to change a thing because everything is working. I'm just going to take this new marble, pop it in roughly the same place. This is where you discover your studio floor isn't completely flat. No, that's staying on. That's okay. That's a good sign. Okay. Try and get roughly the same position and drop myself down a little bit. Yeah, and you can see how that kind of works. That's pretty good. We'll open that up. And then I want to change the colour. So I'm just going to dive into layers, and we'll put an adjustment layer in here, a hue saturation adjustment layer. And with hue saturation, I'm just going to change the master colour to blues. So it'll target just the blues within this scene. So if you want a green one, you can have a green one. If you want to have...
We've got rainbow from David. Yeah. Unicorn.
Unicorn is that's not a colour. So yeah, you can have any colour you like. Obviously, you want to have a red one, you can have a red one in there, and you can change the luminance of it all, and so on, and the saturation, and there you go. Lovely. Okay, that's pretty good. That works quite nicely. Job done. So that is how to take the standard classic book heart shape and kind of twist it around a little bit to make something different. Okay, let's get rid of that and do something completely different. Right, so let's go through the setup of this. So I've made my little red paper heart. I'm going to put it on some red paper, and I think that is the last of my red paper. I bought a whole bunch of this at the beginning of lockdown, and I've used, I think I've got every colour but red left. So red, there it is. It's the shadows that are so vital in this particular setup. I can adjust the height. So if I bring my light a little bit lower down, and I take the same shot again, or as close as I can. Here we go. Okay. Can you spot the difference? Barely. There is a difference, but it is so small, it's almost nothing apart from me zooming slightly differently, nothing between them. And the reason for that is, although I moved the light closer, I didn't actually change the angle. I just physically moved it up and down. And that's not going to change the shadows. If you move a light vertically above your subject, it'll get brighter, but it won't make any difference to the shadows. And this shot lives and dies on the shadows. So what I'm going to do instead is move it like that. Okay, so I've just angled it, you know, just a foot or so further away from where it was before. But the difference is huge. My shutter speed has dropped a little bit. I can handhold that, that's fine. But you'll see the difference in shadows is absolutely enormous. So now we have quite a bit more elongated shadows. Now, which of them is right and which of them is wrong? Well, there isn't a right and a wrong. This is photography, no such thing. Right and wrong is whatever you like and whatever you don't like, assuming it's your image. The other way is to move the light around. So I could move the light in an arc around my subject, just as if the sun was moving around. But it's much easier to move the subject, it really is. So rather than moving the light, I can just move the subject. And that's going to give me a different direction to the shadows and a different feel. Okay, we can go.
So you can see with the light on, can't you, which way the shadows...
There's a massive advantage to continuous lights like the Badger Beam that you can actually see exactly where the shadows are going to fall. And what you see is pretty much what you get through the camera as well, which is a big advantage of the Olympus mirrorless system. What you see through the EVF or the LCD is exactly what you see, what you capture. That includes exposure as well. So if I do one the right way around, because that one's decided to jump on its side, there we go. That is not quite what I'm seeing. It's not really red. That is more of an orangey red. So all I'm going to do is tell the camera to change its exposure by one stop. So I'm in aperture mode. I've dialed in one stop less exposure. And I'll take the same shot again. My shutter speed doubles, which is good news. Oh, and of course it's gone round. There you go. But that gives me a much richer colour. I just go back two shots. That's where we were. And then that's what we're getting. So we're getting a much richer red. And that, for me, that just feels more accurate to what I'm looking for. I think the best lighting for this is with the light coming from the top of the heart so that the shadow comes down towards the back end of the heart. And if I get everything in roughly the right position where I want it to go, something like that, then hopefully I can get a nice little shadow coming off the back. Because what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to create the illusion of three dimensions on something that is two-dimensional. You are looking at a two-dimensional screen. Prints are two-dimensional, and yet we see 3D images when we look at 2D objects. The brain is a remarkable thing. Let's see if we can just get that. There you go. That looks pretty good. I'm happy with that. And we see three dimensions because our brain sees shadows. And where it sees shadows, it interprets shadows as depth. All photographers do this, whether you're a landscape photographer or whether you are a portrait photographer. We use shadows and other visual clues to trick the brain into thinking that there is depth in an image that doesn't actually have it. I mean, that's one of the great things about photography is we are illusionists. We are changing the perception of your brain. It's quite remarkable, really.
We've got to add that to your bio now.
Oh, Gavin Harry, illusionist. Yeah, I want that on, yeah. When we get some new business cards, that's going at the top. We've got, you can just about see it in the corner, some Christmas fairy lights. Lovely little things. Okay, and these are going to be the last way I'm going to make hearts. So we're going to make hearts by using the properties of a lens, something called bokeh, however you want to pronounce it. It's basically blur. So that's what I'm going to call it. So what I've got is a piece of paper that is exactly the same size as the front element of the 45mm f1.2. And as you can see, this is a completely black piece of paper, just like the marble was red. And if you don't believe me that it is black, okay, there it is. There's a close-up of it. Completely black. See what I mean? Okay, so black isn't a colour, black is just the absence of light. And this is quite thick paper. And I'm going to make an aperture that is heart shape. So, fold it in half. There we go. Get yourself some scissors and freezing cold fingers. And start to cut a little heart shape. And once again, I've got one I'm going to use because I can... Oh, I'm so cold. I'm trying to do this and not lose a finger on live streaming. I mean, that would... I mean, we'd go viral, but... And see in the... Which way around is it? That way. Okay, that was terrible. Right. Anyway, there it is. Da, 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 da. Heart shape. So that is, you do that but better, basically. Do that but better. Scissors, round piece of paper, heart shape, as you can see. It fits over the lens and the lens will still be able to see through it.
Apparently that was a half-hearted cut.
Hey, hey! Oh, dear me. dear me. Okay, so I'm going to get my little heart. I am going to push it into the lens, and because I've cut this to shape, it fits perfectly right flush up against the lens. Here we go. Same shot, nothing's changed. Jump back to my laptop. Ta-da! There you go.
Wow, that's so cool.
And that's how easy it is. So I want to be a little bit careful with this because this is a museum piece. Can we go with the overhead camera or the close-up camera? Let's try the close-up. There, that works. It is a light bulb, but not just any light bulb. This is actually a tungsten light bulb.
I thought you were going to say it was a Marks and Spencer's light
bulb. I think it was a Poundland one. That doesn't quite work the same, does it? Okay. And I like to use this one because it just is a bit more interesting than our modern LED light bulbs. I mean, it's not turned on, so we're probably going to be okay. And I just want to have that as my foreground. So in my mind, what's happening is that the light bulb is producing the hearts. That's kind of what I'm thinking. Okay, let's just move my focus. I'm going to focus on the center of the light bulb. I'm going to get it pretty much to minimum focus distance. There we go. Something like that. And we should get a little light bulb coming through. Yeah. I mean, it's all right. We've got to make this better. Okay, so how am I going to improve this picture? Well, there's a few things I can do. The first and easiest one is to take control of the room lighting. So at the moment, we've got the video lights turned on, so you can see what's going on. This could be a completely mad idea, but I'm going to turn the video lights off. And, oh, it's okay. So the camera is doing its level best. It's probably pushed the ISO up to like a million now, but there we go. So now I have the room lights off. I'll take the same shot again. There we go. And hopefully you can spot the difference. There we go. That's room lights on. That's room lights off. And the difference is that that light bulb becomes a bit more of a silhouette. There is definitely a more of a silhouette feel to it because the room lights aren't illuminating the outside of the bulb. It's effectively back illuminated. Although it is brighter in here than I expected thanks to the sun pouring through, but I'm not going to complain about that. So that's okay. Let's see if we can make this better still. Let's see what we can do. So I need to flip around my screen so I can see what's going on. Do love flippy foldy screens. And then I'm just going to gather up the little fairy lights and try to arrange them so they are just coming out from the light bulb only. A little clamp just to clip them onto the back of the fabric. Let's see how that goes. Okay. If I just move my camera position slightly, yeah, that's going to be okay. Lovely. So I've just repositioned them. So I've gathered up a few more of those little lights. So they're now more centered around the bulb. I can probably change the angle a little bit as well and give it a little bit of a tilt. Let's go something like that. There we go. And just check my focus is still focused. And that should give us a nice little kind of diagonal going on, which is really nice. I like that. Pull myself backwards slightly. So I'm just slightly readjusting my position just to make this a little bit different every time. So that's really nice. I like that. That's looking excellent. Let's just have a quick close-up view and see how we're doing. Yeah, look at that. Okay, we've got some beautiful focus going on there. I love what it's doing through the glass. So the bokeh shape, the heart shape, is being distorted as it passes through the cheap Poundland light bulbs. But it is fairly good, despite my dodgy scissor work.
Jane has just asked, how are some of the lights coming out red and some not?
That is a really good question, Jane. So why are some of the lights coming out red and some not? Let me just turn the radio light back on again. Simple reason that, from my point of view, actually, it's probably easier if I just take an in-focus photo to show you that. Okay, just jump back to my laptop. Okay, so that's why. Okay, so this light is much, much brighter than this light. So that is going to be a white heart, and that one is going to be more of a pink heart because it's against red fabric. Okay, so this one is somewhere in between. So that's why you're getting the difference in illumination. It depends where they're actually pointing to what effect you get. The brighter the point of light, and you do need points of light for this to work, the brighter the light that comes through the lens, the brighter the spot of bokeh. Okay, it's as simple as that. It is just down to the individual illuminations that you're seeing there, but that's a really good question. Okay, right, so my last shot. What I've done compared to the last shot is I've turned on the light. There we go. So now we have a little bit of light in there as well, a little glow internally from the light because it's on a small dimmer switch. So I can just have it on a very, very low dimmable setting, and that just completes my final picture. So there we are. We are done for the day. If you're stuck at home, stay safe, keep shooting. I'm Gavin Hoey. Thanks for watching.